Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining. We're going to be talking about Straylight flare testing. My name is Henry Korn. I'm the Chief Product Officer of Imatest. And I am going to introduce you to Jackson Knappen, who is an imaging scientist at Imatest, specializing in Straylight. And I'll go ahead and take it away, Jackson.
All right, thank you.
早安，大家，欢迎大家参加今天早上的这个线上的我们的关于特别关于杂闪光的一个线上的课程啊。我是刚这一位是 Henry Korn， 那是我们公司 Imatest 主要的这个技术指导官、技术官啊。那我要现在介绍的 Jackson 呢，他是我们公司对于杂闪光的专家，他是影像的科学家，所以我们现在来欢迎 Jackson。
Thank you for the introduction, Henry. I'm going to go ahead and get started.
谢谢亨利你的介绍。现在我们开始今天的课程内容。
So here's just an overview of the contents of this presentation. First, we're going to start with some background on Straylight. Then we're going to go into...
我来先介绍一下我们今天课程的一个顺序。我们先介绍什么叫做杂闪光。
Then we're going to go into some of the existing tests for Straylight, followed by the new and developing tests, or how we're testing for Straylight.
再来我们要介绍我们可以怎么样现有的测试的方式，再来是还有新的，还有测试的杂闪光的方式。
And then finally, we'll talk about Imatest solution, both equipment and software for Straylight testing.
再来我们介绍 Imatest 我们的解决方案，包括我们的硬件和软件。
So starting with the background,
我们先来讲一下它的杂闪光的背景。
First of all, what is stray light? Stray light is any light that reaches your focal plane or your image sensor via a non-design optical path. This is the definition from the IEEE P2020 standard that's in development. We'll talk a little bit more about standards later.
我们先看一下杂闪光的一个定义，这是由 IEEE P2020 所定义的。杂闪光是任何的光线，它是非预期的，而且是非设计的一个光学的路径进入到成像的平面。
And you can think of stray light as systematic scene-dependent optical noise in that it will change depending on where the source of light is relative to your camera device.
杂闪光也可以被想作是一个很系统性的，而且是端赖于拍摄的影像的一个光学的噪声。那它对于这个光的光源和这个我们的相机的距离也是有很直接的一个被影响。
There's two terms being used interchangeably here, stray light and flare. Those are both the same thing.They're largely used by different communities where stray light originates from the aerospace and defense industry, and flare is commonly used by the consumer photography industry and also now the automotive industry.
那在英文上面我们有 stray light 还有 flare 两个讲法，其实都是讲一样的事情。 stray light 一般我们翻译成杂闪光，那 flare 也是讲杂闪光或是光斑或是耀斑，其实是讲一样的事情。 stray light通常是用在这个杂闪光是用在航太系统还有在国防的工业里面。那 flare 这个光斑呢，一般我们直翻成为光斑，它是用在消费性的摄像系统还有车载系统。
Veiling glare is another common term that is tossed around. That is a type of stray light. We can talk about that in a little bit.
那 veiling glare 就是有时候会翻成耀斑或是眩光，它也是杂闪光其中一种，这个等一下会提到一些。
So here are some examples of stray light manifesting itself in images. On the top left, you can see an image that's affected by some stray light on the right-hand side, as well as veiling glare, which is reducing the overall contrast in the rest of the image.
像这些影像都是，这些图像是一些杂闪光的一些例子，像左上角我们现在看到这个游标所指示的，我们就看到有一些的过度的这个眩光从右边 进来，从我们图像右边进来，而且并造成整个图像是有点的过曝，它的这个对比降低。
And now moving over to the top right, the picture of the cake, there's a very clear example of what's called ghosting or ghost reflections in this image. You can see a perfect reflection of the light from the candlesticks on top of the cake at the bottom, and that itself is stray light.
那我们再看到右上角的这样这个蛋糕的图片，我们就很清楚的看到一些鬼影或鬼像，就是看到蛋糕的身体我们用红框圈起来的，它就是反射到了这个上面的这个蜡烛的光。
And then finally, moving to the center bottom, this image of the stoplight here. This is an image I took relatively recently. And you can see that the sun is in the field of view, and there's some stray light that's partially blocking the signal, as well as these specular highlights that are caused by debris or contamination on the windshield.
所以我们看到中间左边下中间左边下面数过来下排第三个就是有着这个交通号志的这个图片，我们看到这就是非常明显，这是我最近所拍摄的一个图片，在很强烈的这个阳光之下，它的这个杂光呢就直接的影响到了这个行车的这个灯号。
So why is this a problem?Well, a lot of those examples kind of cover this. Firstly, contrast loss or veiling glare. That's the first one. And you can also have decreased dynamic range due to this or a false signal for your signal noise ratio or dynamic range testing. So your stray light can effectively reduce the overall dynamic range of your imaging system.
所以杂闪光为什么是一个问题呢？第一个，它一定会造成对比的损失，就像是我们刚刚前面看到有着交通号志的这个图片，它会造成或者是眩光的效果，所以让人看不清楚这个我们应该要看的一个景象，而且它会降低动态范围，而且并且会提供错误的信号，在信噪比还有动态范围的测试上面。
You can also see false features or literally objects or shapes that are not there in the scene. These are the ghosts I was talking about, as well as changes in the color of the image.
它也会造成一些错误的一些影像在图像上面，就像是我们刚刚前面蛋糕的这个例子，会看到一些鬼影或鬼像。
And you might say that not all stray light is bad for the artistic photography industry.Some people like stray light. Sun stars, for example, people will stop down their lens just to get stray light because it looks pretty in some cases.
而且我们刚刚讲到它还会改变上我们看到的图像的颜色，可是不是所有的杂闪光都是不好的，有些为了要做一些他自己想要做的艺术性的，或者是为了他要的这个美学上的这个成像，所以他会用利用杂闪光，甚至说停下来等待这个杂闪光而拍摄。
And another note, stray light is becoming more of an issue because we're producing these higher dynamic range sensors, and higher dynamic range sensors are actually more susceptible to stray light.
而杂闪光这个问题呢，越来越被人们重视，一方面也是因为随着成像系统的进步，我们制造更多的宽动态范围的成像系统。所以杂闪光的问题就会更为敏感。
Now on to the causes of stray light. There are a lot of causes for stray light or possible causes.
那到底是什么造成这个杂闪光？有很多的原因。
So this is just a list of some of the potential causes of stray light. I'm not an optical engineer, so I can't go into too much detail into these, but you can have reflections off of your various lens elements. You can have scattering off of parts of the surfaces of your lenses, or things like your filters or lens coatings can also produce these types of reflections. There's many causes.
有非常多的原因，我这边只是列举出一些比较常见的原因，因为我自己不是光学工程师，但是 这个最最常见的一些的原因呢，它就是像在这个镜头里面，还有在这个sensor 在这个里面的这些反射，或者是一些光的进去的绕射，或者是散射，或者是反光，或者是像这个滤镜或者是镜头上面的涂层，都会造成杂闪光。
So now I want to briefly talk about the existing stray light or flare tests that exist today, and then we'll follow up with what's in development.
那我想要跟大家先聊一下现有的杂闪光的测试，那再来我就会带到说我们现在已经在做研发，而且快要可以提供更先进的杂闪光测试的方式。
So first we have ISO 9358. This is a standard for optics and optical instruments. This is a lens-only stray light measurement.
现在我们看到的是 ISO 9358, 是1994年的，这个是一个只测试镜头的一个杂闪光的测试。
So rather than testing your full system or your camera, you're just testing individual optics or groups of optics, and therefore it requires you use a reference detector that's radiometrically calibrated.
那这个需要用到一个已经事先做好这个校正的一个侦测的这个设备，然后来做这个一个或者是数个的光学的元件的测试。
Next, we have ISO 18844. This is a chart-based test, and it involves a backside illuminated chart with these concentric circles in an X pattern.
这个 ISO 18844是2017年版本的这个测试的方式，它就是在一个平面上，它有一些的圆点，或者是我们叫做就是这是有一些的黑的这个黑的圆点，然后用 X 的方式的在这个平面上面所排列。这个是一个基于测试卡的测试方式。
I believe this is the most common test today. It's okay for measuring veiling glare, but it doesn't really give you a overall good measurement of your system's stray light performance. That's partly because it does not consider light outside the field of view.
所以这个对于测试眩光是还可以的，但是对于测试整个系统的杂闪光却不是有太大的帮助，因为它所测试的眩光只在我们测试的这个图像上面而已，但是对于所有这个图像以外的杂闪光它却没有办法做测试。
And also important to note is that it has limited analysis points, so you're really only looking at these black circles here, and so you'll miss stray light features that don't occur at these very exact locations.
所以除了在这个市场外的杂闪光没有办法做测试之外，它在市场内我们只测试到这个X 这些一个个圆点上面的杂闪光，可是对于其他的位置的杂闪光却没有办法做测试。
This type of analysis is supported by IMATEST via the flat field module.
在我们 IMATEST 的软件的云场测试这个模组里面是可以测试这个 ISO 标准的测试方式。
And it's still in use today. There's these upcoming standards that do include this type of measurement, as well as a new type of measurement that we'll talk about here in a second.
在我们的新的版本里面，我们仍然支援这样子的，这个 ISO 的标准测试方式，但是对于新的测试方式，我们也是支援。
So now I want to talk about the new and upcoming test for stray light flare and what IMATEST is working on.
So 现在要提一下，新的还有这个将要发布的测试方式，对于测试杂闪光。
So this slide gives you an overview of the test method. It's relatively simple. It involves capturing images of a small bright light source in a dark room.
那这个方式其实相当的单纯，相当的简易。它就是在一个暗室里面来拍摄这个像我们现在看到移动的一个小的点光源。
So in its simplest form, you could capture a single image of the light source, but in order to build field coverage, which is really important, you need to either rotate the camera or rotate the light source around the camera and capture many images.
所以我们只需要用拍摄这个一个点光源它在移动的一个其中的一个成像，但是很重要的一点是在我们要多几个拍摄，不管是移动相机或你的成像系统，或者是移动这个点光源，然后让这整个图像呢都有被这个点光源所覆盖到。
The captured images are then processed into what we call normalized stray light metric images. And in these metric images, we mask out the light source itself because that is not considered to be stray light.
所以在多个拍摄这个不同的点光源在这整个市场里面，然后我们就这叫做把这个杂闪光统一化的这些的图像，但是在我们在测试的时候不把这个点光源放进去是杂闪光的本身，因为它本身并不是杂闪光，所以它要被遮罩起来，在我们计算的时候它要被用遮罩遮起来。
And this method is meant to correspond with these upcoming standards, IEEE P2020, as well as a new ISO 18844 method. These standards are still in development. We'll talk about them in just a second.
就在 IEEP 2020和ISO 18844这两个标准都是以这个现在来作为一个基准，我们等一下会再讨论。
So here we can take a closer look at that sample test data. And on the right side, you can see the test setup that we used here at ImmaTest to capture this data.
所以在这里我们看到我们左边这个所显示出来这个连续的影像就是由右边的我们这样子的设备所拍摄出来的。
So in the setup, we have a camera mounted to a motorized gimbal. So we're rotating the camera in front of a bright light source to capture this data.
所以大家可以看到这是一个非常稳定把这个成像系统或者相机所架设起来，而且是可控的距离，还有它可以自动调整它移动的速度还有方向，所以才能够做到左边这样子，我们可以非常的很好的操控整个这个点光源在整个图像上的位置。
Now, field coverage is something that's really important for this type of test method. You can see we're doing multiple sweeps across different axes, so horizontal, vertical, and both diagonals.
所以这边看到说，整个的画面它都需要有这个点光源，它的都有把它包含进去，这是非常非常重要在这个测试上面。大家可以看到，由于是在这个很稳定的。这个把这个成像系统的装置在这个硬这个设备上面，所以很好的控制这个点在很重要在不同轴向上面的呈现。
For comprehensive testing, you would want to capture as many images in as many positions as possible, including where the light source is positioned outside the field of view of the camera.
在比较复杂的杂闪光的测试上面，不只是在我们要这个市场里面的这杂闪光，我们在这个市场外的杂闪光，我们也是需要设置一些市场外的光源来测试。
You could just do a single axis sweep, such as a horizontal sweep of the light source, but then you would be assuming radial symmetry, and there could be some asymmetry in your optical straight light performance. And so that's why we're recommending multiple axis sweeps of the light source.
当然一般是想说我们只用单一方向的光源，比如说水平上面的光源，但是我们会要考虑到这个镜像的对称性。那如果说真的是它你可以把这个对称性的掌握得非常好，那那是当然就是可以，但是通常来讲这是非常难达到的。所以在同样一个方向只有一个方向，如果只有水平的，它可能对于这个系统的对称性它所反射出来的光源就不会是很均匀，所以我们还是会建议说要这个光源要在不同轴向所设置。
So I want to talk a little bit more about these standards that are in development. Again, they're still developing, but there's multiple standards bodies working on a new stray light test method that corresponds to what we're talking about here today. And IMATEST is actively involved with these standards. We're committed to supporting them.
那有各种不同的标准研究的制定的单位都是在强调现在有这个杂闪光的标准。
The first two that IMATEST is involved with, IEEE P2020 and ISO 18844. P2020 is in a pre-release state right now, and it's expected to officially release in 2023, likely late 2023.
那我们现在看到最上面两个 IEEP 2020 还有这个 ISO 18844 这两个标准都是 IMATEST 我们都是很直接的就在这个开发的这个委员会里面这个开发小组那还有 IEEE 的 P4001 这个是宽光谱的这个测试我们也是很这个在这个小组的中心那 应该是明年年底 2023年年底 会发布这个新的一个测试标准
And as I mentioned before, ISO 18844 is developing a new method that's going to be very, very similar to the IEEE P2020 method, but they're two separate standards.
那虽然 刚刚前面有提到 ISO 18844 跟 IEEP 4001 是 两个是非常相似的，只是他们是在不同的标准制定单位里面所制定，但是其实测试方式是非常的相似。
Some additional standards to consider are IEEE P4001, which is the standard for hyperspectral testing. We know that they're working to develop a new method, as well as ISO TC172, the optics and photonics standard. This is the same group that made the ISO 9358 test. And then we know that they're looking to update their standard.
那 IEEP 4001 跟这个 ISO TC 172 这两个也是制定这个像 ISO 9358 他们会在更新关于杂闪光的这个测试标准。就所以这上面的是两组不同的测试。 Yes.
A little bit more on P2020 flare. Again, it's in a pre-release state and it's expected to release in 2023. It defines two test methods.
在 IEEP 2020的炫光或者叫杂闪光的这个测试，它有两组不同的方式。
Method A is very similar to the existing ISO 18844 test, but instead of using a flat test chart, it uses something that's akin to a hemisphere.
那第一种呢，这个方式A呢，它其实测试方式就像是本来的 ISO 18844-2017版，但是不同的是，它不是在一个平面的测试卡上测试，它是一个半球形的测试的一个标的。
And method B is similar to the method that we're describing now. And they say that you can rotate either the device under test or you can rotate the light source.
那 B 第二种方式呢，就像是我们刚刚前面看到的，你在拍摄的时候，不然就是移动你的点光源，不然就是移动你的成像系统或你的相机。
We also know of this China QCT standard 1128 for glare and ghosts. This was published in 2020, and it's specifying separate measurement of glare and ghosts.
那在中国的 QCT 1128关于杂闪光和鬼影或鬼像的这个测试，它应该是在这个2020年所发布的。那它比较，它是把这个测试鬼影和
The glare test has an interesting setup involving a reflective mirror and a point source. IMATEST is planning on supporting this measurement in an upcoming release.
那在 glare 就是炫光这个测试呢，我们的软件会在新的版本支援。
Meanwhile, the go setup, which is a very similar setup to what we're describing here, this is not on IMITA's short or medium term roadmap. And that's because it requires identifying and localizing the ghost features in the image.
那在对于鬼影鬼像的这个测试呢，我们近期在我们的软件上面不会支援的，可是它是相对来讲简单，它就是，在同一个点上，它把这个鬼影鬼像成像的位置表示出来。
And that's hard to do because the ghosts can come in so many shapes and sizes and different forms. So to be able to identify exactly what they are and where they are is something that's difficult to do in software.
那这个原因就是在说这个鬼影鬼像它可能呈现是不同的尺寸大小不同的形状不同的位置它可能会偏移移动所以在现在有的软件的分析上面是还比较难达到的
So now that we've talked about these, the overall solution and the method, I want to talk about the IMITA Straylight testing solution, our hardware and software.
我们现在来讲一下 IMATEST 的关于杂闪光的测试的解决方案，包含这个硬件和软件。
So to test for stray light, in terms of equipment, all you really need are three things.
在这个测试的这个设备上面，我们只需要三个东西。
One, just a dark or black room. Then you also need a bright light source.And then third, a way to rotate your camera under test, or alternatively, move the light source around your camera.
So, 一个就是要在一个暗房里面，第二个就是要很亮的可控的这个光源，第三个就是要有非常精确可以可调的这个相机，在这个测试里面，或者是很可以可调的光源。
We opted to go the modular route, so to have separate pieces of equipment. And with that, we have an IMATEST motorized gimbal, which is meant to rotate your camera about two axes. And we're also developing some new light sources.
刚刚讲到可调，第三个可调的光源，除了是可调的这个光源本身，还有它的位置，重点是它的位置。那对于这个是可以用马达来控制它的。像刚刚我们前面有影像所看到的这个相机的方向和位置，还有在可调的这个光源的方向和位置，这都是我们正在开发中的。
A little bit more detail about this motorized gimbal. It provides two axes of rotation, roll and yaw, and these will correspond with azimuth angle and field angle of the light source if the camera is properly set up and aligned.
那这个我们现在大家所看到的我们这个设备它可以提供两个不同的角一个是方位角还有一个是偏离角像一般我们讲的是翻滚或者是偏离那这都可以很好的用马达来做控制
The camera is meant to be mounted so that it's very frontmost the front of the camera is positioned at the center of rotation so this figure is a little inaccurate the camera should be pushed back just a little bit
我们现在看到这个图片来讲，其实这个相机其实应该还要再往后移一点，然后所以对于它的不同的这个两轴的这个角度会有更好的操作。
So this is just meant to provide flexible and accurate movement, and then we also mount it to a goniometer so that it you can adjust the pitch of the system, and that will help with alignment.
那这个硬件呢，这个设备它就是可以提供很有弹性，而且非常精确的这个相机的这个移动，并且还可以配合一个侧角仪来去针对我们的角度有非常精确的控制。
Azimuth angle and field angle are two terms that you may be familiar with if you have an optics background.
如果你是一个光学背景的话，对于这个方位角或者对于这个偏离角或者有人说是视场角可能会比较熟悉
So field angle is moving radially outward in the field and azimuth angle is moving around the circle
所以所谓的翻滚或者方位角呢它就是在这个圆圈的外围这样子来移动可是如果说是叫做另外一个是偏离角的话它就是在这个镜像的上面来移动。
Now onto the light source. There are a lot of options with respect to light sources that you can use for stray light testing, but it does have a huge impact on the test and the measurement.
那对于光源来讲，对所有的测试，光源都是相当的重要。可是相对，在我们测试杂闪光，它比较的，它的重要性还没有说这么的放在首位。
One option that we're proposing is to use a broadband halogen fiber optic illuminator. And we paired this with an optical breadboard and our motorized gimbal to create a benchtop stray light testing solution.
所以我们在这里所用的光源就是一个最基本的光纤卤素光源。那把这个光源呢，就是设置在现在大家所看到的这个平台上面。在平台上面，除了这个光源里可以控的这个光源位置以外，还有就是刚刚在平台的右边，大家可以看到，就是刚刚前面的这个设备，就是可以把相机用很可控的两轴的这个翻滚的定位方位角，还有视场角这个移动的这个硬件的设备。
We have a collimation optic attached to the fiber, and that helps focus the beam into a narrower, albeit still diverging beam of light.
那在这光源里面，我们用一个光纤一个管，所以让它是可以很好的对齐我们要拍摄的这个相机，然后不管是在对齐的位置，还有距离都可以很好的控制。
So in general, you can use light sources like this, diverging sources, for repeatable stray light testing, as long as your setup remains constant. And by setup, I mean the distance from the camera to the source and the alignment of the camera within the beam of light. That needs to remain constant.
所以不管是像用任何的像这样的光源，是一个发散的光束，只要是它是一个很稳定可控，可以是很精确的位置还有对齐的这个光源都是可以的，而且最重要就是说它是可以可控，并且是可以很好的被重复来做拍摄的，来做测试。
This is a setup that we're already offering to sell, but we're also developing a new light source.
这个测试的方式是我们已经现在可以提供给各位的，那我们还有新的这个测试的方式，还有光源，我们现在也在研发。
So we're partnering with a company called LabSphere, who is an aerospace and defense company, to produce this highly configurable light source that we're designing specifically for stray light testing.
那我们跟一个公司叫 LabSphere 的公司合作，它是一个航太和这个 国防防御工业。那它在我们在这个杂闪光的测试上面有很密切的合作。
It uses a small integrating sphere with a radiance monitor detector mounted to it, and that allows you to generate uniform and very controlled light output.
它是一个有一个很小的积分球，然后有一个这个光源的这个荧幕的这个监视器在放在一起集成在一起的一个设备。
It has three ports for swappable LED engines, so you could combine different spectra or wavelengths.And then the integrating sphere will mix those wavelengths together to produce a single uniform light source.
它可以有提供一个可以去更换的 LED 的这个引擎，那可以有三不同，你可以去更换不同的波长的光源，然后集成在这个积分球里面做测试。
The idea is to have this highly configurable source where you can customize the geometry of the light.And also the wavelength or the spectrum.
那这个高度客制化的，你可以自己在测试上面呢，可以不管是你的几何，还有你的光源，还有你的波长的需要，你可以自己去做应用。
The main purposes of this light is to be able to produce collimated light. So it has these adjustable front optics that will let you produce a collimated beam.Or also a diverging beam if you'd want.
所以这个最重要的，它就是可以有一个发散或者是一个集中的光束，你可以自己来做调整。
It also has an adjustable iris inside of the optics, which lets you control the size of the light source as seen by the camera, which is really important to the measurement.
所以在这个测试上面非常重要的一个就是它的这个轴向还有这个、方向是非常好的 被控制和调整，还有你拍摄的物体的这个尺寸大小，就是像光源的尺寸大小。
And we're expecting this piece of equipment to be ready or available in the beginning of 2023.
在明年初，这个这样子的设备就可以提供给大家使用。
If you're not familiar with integrating spheres, they're coated with this highly reflective material on the inside that supports a wide or broad range of wavelengths. So theoretically, you could plug in any wavelength you wanted in the visible or near infrared spectrum, and this should be able to support that.
所以对于积分球，可能如果有些人不太熟悉的话，这就是一个积分球的一个大概的介绍。它是一个球体，在里面有非常均匀的涂布了这个白色的这个物体，所以它可以吸收还有反射的这个光谱是非常的广，包括了我们可见不可见光的这个光谱范围。
And then just to give an idea of what diverging light and collimated light are, for good repeatability and for standard compliance, you'll probably want to use collimated light. However, the idea is you want to overfill the front of the camera. So for some larger systems, such as systems with a windshield in front of them, you might need a larger or a diverging beam.
所以还有我们刚刚所提到这个系统可以测试发散光束还有准值的光束，那他们的应用不一样。那我们比如说如果说你说很大的一片这个封板的话，封板就是我们汽车前面这个封板的话，那你可能就需要一个是一个发散的光束。
So that was the hardware solution. Now I want to talk about the software analysis solution.IMATES released our first stray light analysis software in our recent 22.2 release.
那我现在来介绍一下软件的部分，在我们的 IMATES 软件22.2版本。
So the analysis is quite simple. It involves taking the images that you've already captured, selecting them in IMATES.And then IMATES will generate these stray light metric images along with a bunch of other outputs.
So, 就是从我们刚刚这样的测试的方式，把这些测试的结果输入到我们软件里面。大家可以看到，有比较直观的这个伪色彩的图像，还有不同的这个报表。
The metric image itself is the main output from the analysis.
所以这个最重要的这个分析的图呢，就是在这个测试上面的。你看，我们现在看到这个点光源的这个测试，我们这边会讲到。
So the metric we're using in our initial release is something called point source rejection ratio, or PSRR for short.
我们所用的就是这个 PSRR 的这个测试的。这个方式。
And in these metric images, essentially you have every pixel in the input image remapped to represent a metric. So all of the data has been normalized.
所以所有在这个测试里面，所有的所测试的数据都被统一归一化。
And because it's been normalized, PSRR has values of 0 to 1 or ranging from 0 to 1.
所以这个PSR 电源波纹抑制比它整个的我们的测试，因为把它通通都归一化了，所以它的数值从零到一。
To calculate PSR is relatively simple. You're taking an on-axis image of the light source, such as the one pictured here, and then you're normalizing the rest of the image data by the level within the main projection of the light source.
所以这个的分析和测试相对的简单，你就是把所有的这个我们所拍摄到它的这个点光源在不同的位置上的这个RAW 档，然后把它转变到这个伪色彩的这个有把这个色彩映射到这个图像上 PSR 的这个图像上。
The main projection of the light source, the light source object, is masked out in the metric images because ideally that's all the camera should see. Everything else is stray light.
那很重要的在这测试上面是把真正的我们在拍摄所有点光源的光源本身把它遮盖掉。那在除了这个光源本身，所有其他的光都是杂散光。
And this is a metric that's actually been used a lot by the aerospace and defense industry for decades. We found papers and manuals that date back to the 1970s that include point source rejection ratio.
其实这个测试的方式在航太和国防防御工业里面，其实在1970年就已经有了，它是已经所实行很久的，只是在在民间它是还没有开始很大幅被使用。
So the analysis software can produce these PSRR metric images both as still frames or also as movies. And this is probably the easiest and most simple way to assess the stray light performance of your camera.
所以在这个软件上的测试，不管是静止或是动态的这个影像都可以被测试，但都是用一样的这个指标。
You can look at these movies and identify key artifacts,or key areas that are susceptible to stray light, and they're more telling than any single number or metric could ever be.
那在这个动态的这个图像的这个分析里面，你可以看到不同的位置，还有看到可能有任何的瑕疵，都看得非常清楚，比任何其实静态的分析都要来得清晰。
Here's an example of a result from a near-infrared camera with an ultra-wide field of view lens.
这里我们看到是用一个很超广角的镜头拍摄一个近红外的一个影像。
So this data shows a 220 degree horizontal sweep of the light source with increments of 1 degree.
Hello.
You can see that specific.
Hello. Sorry, I just lost you.Hello.
Hello, can you hear me?
Hello, cannot hear you. Yes, now. Sorry, I missed you.
Hello. So this shows a 220 degree horizontal sweep of the light source with increments of 1 degree. The light source isn't masked out in these images, but you can see a lot of interesting artifacts occurring in and outside the image circle in a very specific
way. 这个是一个185度的超广角的这个鱼眼相机而且是在一个220度的水平的这个光源移动所拍摄的。那我们已经把这个光源本身所遮罩遮下割下来了，但是我们可以看到在它的周围有非常多很有趣的一些光晕或者是一些杂光。
So one of the main ways we output these metric images is as these FITS files, or Flexible Image Transport System File Format.
那我们把这样的图像用 BIT 这种的档案格式呢，这个文件格式输出来，因为这个是一个非常有弹性、很好编辑的一种格式。
This is a file format that's been developed by the astronomy community primarily. And so the astronomy communityhave developed these tools, such as the one pictured on the right, for analyzing FITS files.
那这种 FITS file, F-I-T-S 的这种文件格式，它本来是应用在这个天文学界里面所运用的，所以它在转档案，还有在一些在比较精细还有的这个光源分析，已经是非常成熟。
So, for example, the images from Hubble Space Telescope or James Webb Space Telescope.There's a good chance those were analyzed or saved as FITS files, and that's how they're passed around.
像不管在哈勃或者是其他的天文望远镜，都是用这个 FITS 的档案格式。
So the data in the FITS file is floating point rather than, for example, 8-bit 0 to 255. You can have decimal values in these FITS files.
那这样子的档案格式，它并不是像一般的八位元或是零到十六位元，它可以有小数点。
So then you could take these FITS files and do supplemental analysis on them, either visually or in software. You could read them in programmatically, or you could squeeze out as much information as you wanted, using an application like this.
所以这样子的应用非常的广泛，你可以用其他的方式，不管是用用视觉的，或是用其他的软件或者是程序来做分析。
As I mentioned, we also have these extra derived metrics and outputs, such as these histograms and plots. So these are derived from the metric image data, and these can provide some high-level insight into what's going on.
那我还提供大家可以看到，就是依照的刚刚这个移动这个图像，它也随时呈现分析的直方图还有曲线图，那它可以这样可以有非常细节的数据。
So you can plot as many percentiles of the data as you want. In this case, we're plotting mean 95th, 75th, and 50th percentile. And those reveal a jump in the stray light at the very edge of the field of view when plotted.
所以在这个里面可以看，也可以，你可以指定很多不同的，不同的这个细节，指定可以把它指出来在这个所有的数据里面。
The histograms essentially show the distribution of stray light for every metric image. We're not exactly sure how useful these will be, but we want to get these types of tools in the hands of people who are actually testing this and see how much use they can get out of it.
所以我们增加了这样子可以不同的百分位，你可以在这个图上面，还有不同的这个很细节的分析数据的功能，希望在这个测试里面让它可以提供越多的这个分析的数据给大家。
We also output standard output files, including JSON, CSV, and HDF5.
那它也可以输出用一般的比较通用的档案格式，比如说 JSON, JSONS, 或者是CSV 等等。
And these will hopefully include all the summary statistics and information you would ever need for additional analysis. For example, if you wanted to set pass-fail criteria, you could probably do that based on the JSON.
而且还有可以存在这个HDF5 的这种档案格式里面，那这个可以提供非常清晰的一些数据，也简单的来读取。那在我们之前，大家如果用过我们的软件，知道我们都是用 JSON。这个档案格式，然后你可以来设置允拒收的一个阈值。
HDF5 is another astronomy-related data format commonly used by NASA, and that's going to contain all of the data, including the images or the metric images themselves.
那刚刚提到 HDF5， 这个是由这个美国太空总署 NASA 在天文上面所使用的一种文件格式，它可以提供非常非常很精细的数据可以供分析。
Now I want to talk about some observations based on the limited results we've showed today.
那我想要来看一下我们的测试它的一些样本，我们刚刚所谈到的。
Here is an example that highlights the importance of field coverage or test coverage.So the left and right images only differ by 1 degree field angle.
所以这里我们要提到很重要，在这个测试上面，在这个整个视场角的这个所涵盖的领域，这个非常重要。那我们左边和看到的，左边和右边看到的呢，它是一个一个视场角这个不同才一度的差别，那是个拍摄出来的不同的一个结果。
This is probably not the best example of this, but there are so many cases where stray light only pops up at very specific angles. And that's why it's really important to consider field coverage. Even smaller field angle increments of 0.1 degrees might be necessary if you're really trying to do comprehensive testing.
所以大家可以看到，这只是一度，甚至有时候到0.1度视场角的差别，它的这个杂闪光的进入成像就有很大的差异。
Another observation, stray light can often appear when the light source is at angles well outside the camera's field of view. Here's an example where you see some stray light appear on the opposite side of the image, when the light source is positioned outside the field of view.
那有些时候这些杂闪光是在这个市场角之外的，比如说我们现在看到杂闪光其实是这个光源可能是在市场角的外的左边，但是这个杂闪光却出现在我们成像的右边，看到了这个杂闪光的这个像回影一样的状况。
Another observation, stray light can differ vastly between color channels, so you might want to pay particular attention to the difference between the response and color for stray light. Here, the red channel is particularly susceptible to this petaflare artifact.
那有时候呢，我们在观察里面，除了是有这个这个杂闪光会造成色彩的一个变异，那它在不同的色彩的通道会有影响到色彩的响应，所以看到我们这个上面有三个通道，它就出现不同的杂闪光的响应。
Something else we've seen is the importance of using linear image data as input.
那有时候我们是用非线性的这个来做响应。
So on the left, we have a processed RGB image, and on the right, we have an equivalent unprocessed or linear image.
那所以我们可以把这个我们的分析把它线性化，左边是还没有做过处理的，右边是经过线性化处理的。
The banding artifacts in the image on the left are being quantified as stray light, but in reality, they're not stray light. So this highlights the importance of using linear image data when measuring stray light.
这非常重要，像我们看到左边这个，它只是有这个这个杂闪光的量化，可是它并不是有一个线形的把它线形化的一个图像，所以我们把它线形化的这个处理是相当的重要。
Those are the main slides we wanted to cover today. Overall, this recent release of ImageTest 22.2 is a step towards defining and supporting this next generation of stray light analysis within all of these standards.And we're committed and dedicated to supporting these things.
所以在我们的新的 ImageTest 22.2 版本，它就是一个非常大的一个对于杂闪光测试的一个很大的一个进步。那尤其是它可以符合现在所有还有未来将要发布的这个各项的标准的测试。
So thank you very much to everyone who's attending here and listening. We have several links here to our website and documentation where you can learn more about stray light and our solution offerings.
很谢谢大家今天的聆听。那在我们的网页上面，大家可以看到里面还有很多更详细的一些文件，还有资讯对于杂闪光的测试，欢迎大家上网来看。
Thank you, Jackson.
谢谢 Jackson.
We can take questions in the chat, or you can raise your hand and ask them. We have our first question from Stephen Zhu, who says, thanks, Jackson. We discussed lots of method to capture and subjective test of ghosting, but how to objectively judge which lens ghosting is worst, based on intensity, based on area, based on ghosting source to distance, or based on their color?
OK, 我们现在有一些问答的时间，谢谢 Stephen Zhu。那他是说我们讨论了很多关于拍摄还有这个主观的这个测试对于这个鬼影或鬼像。但是如何来很客观的去分析这些鬼影或鬼像所基于可能是它的这个密度还有区域还有这个看光源的这个位置还有距离还有它的颜色等等。
So unfortunately, I think there needs to be both subjective and objective analysis of stray light for some tests, for some systems. So the key is to normalize by something meaningful. So the PSRR metric involves normalizing by a value. And so if all of your data is normalized the same, then you can compare different cameras. You canassess the stray light based on area intensity of the PSR metric and some summary statistics.
所以大部分这些测试呢都是比较是主观而多于客观的，但是我们如果说把所有的测试的结果都用 PSR 的方式把它归一化的话，那就可以来比较各种这个我们测试的不同的结果，然后就可以是相对来讲是一个客观的一个 比较后的一个测试。 那在比较中间你就可以用基于它的密度、它的位置、它的范围和它的距离来做一个比较。 Steven 朱同学，有回答到你的问题吗？
So next question I have
OK 谢谢
is from the question is, what is the difference between PSRR and flare attenuation in decibels, which is used in P2020? Will Emitest use flare attenuation in the future?
第二个问题是一个匿名的一个参加者，那他是问说PSRR 和这个耀斑的在这个 用的 dB 来做测试跟 P2020, 那我们是用 PSR, 我们是用flare attenuation 来做测试。
So the PSRR and flare attenuation metrics are very similar. I will say that the flare attenuation metric is very subject to change, considering that the standard is still in development.
那其实 PSR 和这个耀斑衰减的这个测试，它是相当的类似的。那只是在耀斑衰减的测试它是相对来讲主观一点。
We are planning on supporting the P2020 metrics in a future release.
那在我们未来的新的版本我们会支援 P2020 的测试。
Another key difference is that PSRR is based on image data only, while the flare attenuation metric utilizes some radiometric measurements, specifically illuminance.
那比较大的一个差别呢，就是耀斑衰减它的测试比较是在它的这个镜像环状的这个光源，那这个PSR 它比较是在这个这个图像的数据。好，谢谢。
Okay, next question. I think there's
next one. Yes.
You see that one?
Lee, yes. 1053, right?
Yes.
Okay, so which kind of point source, color temperature or the illuminance is the most appropriate? Is number one.
I think it's going to depend on what sources of concern you're worried about. So if your primary source of concern is the sun, you'll probably want to match the characteristics of the sun with the source you're using to test.
这个李宇科同学你问的第一个什么样的顶光源色温照度是最合适的，那Jackson 的意见是说那是端赖于你所要测试的一个应用，比如说如果说你比较在乎的是一般的太阳光，那所以你的光源的这个特质性质就是要符合的你需要测试的太阳光。Is that it, Jackson?
Yes.
Okay, so number two. So regarding to the point source, the straight light not in the scene. So which illuminance is, according to which illuminance we make the normalization?
So for PSRR, you're utilizing that on-axis reference image. So that reference image, the on-axis reference image, is used to normalize the data in all of the other images, including where the light source is positioned outside the field of view.
所以在 PSRR 这种测试方式里面，它是把这个光源在这个轴向上的通通都包含进去，不管是在你的画面内和画面外的这个光源都会被分析在里面，都会在分析在里面作为归一化。好，第三点number three. So can we appoint to make our own histogram according to our own specified percentile? 应该是probably I think it's a typo percentile.
So if the question is like, what percentiles to use, or can you use your own?
Yes, can you use your own?
Yes, so.
To make the histogram.
So the histogram shows the entire distribution of data, but you can choose to output specific aggregations, whatever you want. You could choose 95th, 96th, 97th percentile. We have it very flexible, so you can set whatever percentile metric you want in the output.
是的，现在我们看到在现在显示上面的这整个直方图里面的这个百分比就是非常的，它所显示出来的是非常的丰富的一个数据资料，所以你可以去设置你自己想要去指定的百分位是没有问题的。你可以从里面，从这个非常非常丰富的这个数据资料，这个直方图里面，可以找到自己想要的百分位。Number four, can we input the images in batch to calculate?
Yeah. So the idea is you would collect many images. So you would have, for example, a folder full of images, and you analyze them in batch. So you'd read them all in at once.And produce metrics for all of the images.
第四个是可以的，你可以是把所有的你要的这个照片或图像，就是把它都存在同一个这个档案夹里面，然后同时一起的读取做分析计算。Number five, does fit format? How does the fit format come from? How does it? Yes.
So as I said, it's a format that originated from the astronomy community. And it simply contained, it allows for storing floating point or scientific image data rather than sticking to a standard image format like a JPEG, which has 8-bit data, for example.
就是我们刚刚有提到的，它是本来就是在这个天文领域上已经用了很久的一种档案。格式文件，它是一种浮动式的格式文件，它并不会受我们一般所使用的8位或者是16位这样子的一个限制，它是一个浮动的，可以自己去编辑的一种这种文件。李同学可以吗？有没有回答到你的问题？如果说有些问题你刚刚还没有完全回答，请再往下面再写下来。Okay, so
next person, Jean Lee, you can unmute yourself and talk.
Jean Lee, I don't see her name.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, 你好。
Sorry, I can't hear the voice.
We can hear you.
我们可以听到你哦。
Do you have a question?
你有问题吗？有一位，
Okay, maybe we can come back later. Hi, we can hear you.
Hi, 我们听得到你啊，请说。
Okay, we'll try again afterwards. So the next question is for display monitor systems, which usually use IR sensors in automotive. Is there any necessity to test flare? Is there equipment recommended or regulated for the test?
好，莫雨桐同学哦，莫雨桐同学，他说，用 DMS 的这种应用的话 ，just keeping. Okay, 应用的话，如果是用这个红外的这个传感器 ，Why is keep jumping？ 传感器在这个车载的系统上面，所以有没有需要去测试这个耀斑？那有没有任何的这个硬件还有设备来做这个测试
？So I think I can answer this one. I think it's definitely because you have a lot of sunlight.Coming into the cabin of the car, and also lights from headlights. Stray light is very important for DMS systems.
所以对杂闪光对于 DMS 的这个应用是非常非常重要的，像如果说像头灯这一类。
The automotive P2020 standard is definitely intended for systems such as DMS systems. And as far as light source, you could use a light source that complies with that standard or something that resembles either headlights or the sun.
那在这个车载系统的 P2020 的这个标准呢，在这个 DMS 系统里面，这是非常重要。比如说像你的头灯，还有像你的所会碰到的平日的太阳光等等。
Next question: Will the setup of and software support only lens level stray light test? Sometimes we need to figure out the stray light is coming from the lens or as a module at prototyping.
OK， 这个谭同学，谭伟德，这个设置在这个软件的这个应用，如果是，是不是可以只是在这个镜头的这个可以？还有另外一个，我们有时候会需要知道，是不是这个杂闪光是从这个模组或者是从镜头而来？
So the answer is, this is just a system level test. It's, you need to use an image sensor, so it can't just test the lens on its own.
这个测试是已经把整个系统所整合起来了，所以不能够只是测试镜头，单一的镜头。
But you should look at the ISO 8960, because that is a lens only test standard.
那前面我们刚刚有提到了这个ISO 的前就是只是测试镜头，那就要去看 ISO 的另外一个 ISO 18960。
Sorry, ISO 9358.
ISO 9358，它就是只是测试镜头单一的镜头，所以你就去看。如果你只要测试镜头，就去看那个 ISO 的标准。那我们现在因为是基于这个应用和业界需求的整合，我们就整合是在整个系统的这个整个系统的测试。
Okay, so there was just a collection of other questions. Sorry that we haven't been able to answer all the questions. There was quite a few of them. If you would like to contact us afterwards, we'll try to answer all the questions offline.
因为我们的时间的关系，所以有一些的问题呢，现在没有办法在线上所回答。但是欢迎你直接跟我们联系，那我们会在线下，跟你有直接的回复。
So there was a set of questions we got in advance, and I just have some of the answers here. This question was, does stray light test need special equipment to shoot?
这边有事前提出的一个问题，这个同学说杂闪光是不是需要一些很特别的设备来拍摄？
So this basic concept requires taking the picture of a small source in a dark room, and there's many possible sources that can be used.
像我们刚刚提到，它需要在一个暗房里面用一个小的这个顶光源来做测试。那这个光源有很多很多不同的光源，可以来使用。
When it comes to standardized approaches, light sources are defined in those standards.
那所以这些光源呢，它就来定义这个标准。
Many of these standards are under development, so it's we can't be totally sure whether the light sources we have right now are going to exactly match those standards.
但是因为标准都还在制定当中，所以我们现在所提供的光源，它你自己手上用的光源还不见得是可以是符合这个测试的标准。
As far as the rotation stage.Stray light can be sensitive to small changes in light source field angle.
像我们刚刚前面讲到的，它这个杂闪光对于一点点的旋转或者是角度的改变是非常敏感的。
So the rotation of the source is required, And this can be done manually, but we prefer to use the automated system for that.
所以这个光源还有这个拍摄的角度的改变，那所以我们会建议用，非常的可以好可控的这个设备。
The next question was
手动或者是自动的来做调整。Yes.
Next question was, can an image be imported into ImageTest Master for calculation?
那这个问题呢是这些拍摄的图像可不可以被输入到这个 ImageTest Master 这个版本作为计算？
And yes, you can use ImageTest Master 22.2 with one or more images.
对，在我们的22.2版本就可以做这样子的一个计算。
Or you can use a configuration file that has the metadata, the field angles for the captures that are in that config file.
那你可以用单一的或是多个图像这个批量的一起来读取计算，或者是你可以用一个已经做过的这个计算的这个档案，然后来去定义，然后可以去做这样子的计算。
Next question is, well, what is the color temperature illuminance distance requirement for the light source?
下个问题是，什么样的色温还有光源距离，对于我们要拍摄这个测试这个顶光源。
So wavelength is a factor that you can measure stray light over. You should at least use a broadband source that covers the range of response of your camera.
所以这个波长或是颜色是非常重要的，对于做于测试的杂散光，最基本的最少你要这个波长呢，你必须要是一个宽频的这个波长是可以超过你要测试的成像系统。
You can use a narrow band light to determine which spectrum are have more or less stray light.
像这个带通一定要超过这个你的这个相机的带通。那对于比较窄的这个窄带的这个带这个光源呢，那你可能是要比较是你比较关心某一个光谱里面的这个光源。所以就是说是要端赖于你所要测试的这个光源。
The next factor is the illuminance or the light level. You can either pick a level that everyone uses the same light level.
所以还有另外一个是光的亮度。那你可以把所有的都是设置在一样的光亮度。
You can pick a level that makes sense for your application or a level that make sense for the type of stray light you're testing.
那你可以是用你因为你的应用所需要，所以设置你的光亮度，或者是因为你所要测试的这个系统，所以来定义你的光亮度。
This series of images shows different stray light measurements with the same camera but with different exposures.
那我们现在看到这四个图像就是同一个成像系统同一个相机可是是不同的曝光所呈现出来的。
So on the left, you can measure faint stray light patterns, but lose the ability to measure stray light near the source because of saturation.
那最左下角这个是因为这个的饱和所以你可能会失去了一些在这个顶光源周边的这个测试的一个结果。
On the right, you lose the faint stray light patterns, but have the ability to measure stray light patterns.
那在最右边我们只能测试这个杂散光的这个样貌，但是我们可没有测试到很多杂散光这个强度。
So this may mean that multiple light levels are needed to fully characterize the stray light performance of a camera.
所以我们这个例子就来说明在同一个相机里面成像系统那你可能是需要不同的曝光程度和不同的亮度来测试同一个成像系统它的杂散光的表现。
Finally, about distance, if you're testing with a collimated light, the light source distance should not matter.
如果你是用一个准直光的话，那这个距离就不是很重要。
If you're testing with a diverging or converging light source, the distance should be recorded as part of the test report.
但是如果说你是一个收敛或发散角的这个光源的话，那这个距离就是重要。
Because this type of test does not distinguish between stray light and blur, testing near the working distance of the camera is a good idea.
那因为如果说是不是准直光的测试的话，那这个拍摄的时候还有分析，它并没有办法去去分辨说是杂闪光还是是一个模糊，所以这个时候那就是这个光源越靠近成像系统，就是相机会比较理想一点。
The different standard bodies may need to prescribe a test distance, but it's not clear that this will happen at this point.
那这是我的标准，它可能在这个部分它并不会去做一个比较多的这个强调和分析。
I think this is the last question. How do you check for the spot size of the light source?
所以这最后一个问题，我们怎么样去检查这个光源里面的这个点，光点。
So there's the spot size, the uniformity of the spot, the expansion and level.
那在这个光点有很多个不同的性质，比如说是它的尺寸大小、它的均匀度、它的扩散度，还有它的亮度。
So the spot that's projected at your camera should fill your front element and any part of the camera.Such as the baffles that see that front element by a direct line.
所以这个光点呢，在你的相机里面，它应该是要充满在你整个前面的这个所有的这个元素里面，比如说像任何的你的相机里面的部件。
So if you have a
包括你那个相机的挡板等等。
If you have a large optic.This means that it is easier to use diverging light for a large optic.
所以它有时候会比较容易用一些比较不同的这个发散性的这个光源去把这整个，如果说你要拍摄整个你的成像系统是比较大的，所以用发散性的光源会比较容易把整个成像系统把它充满在里面。
For uniformity, we place a white paper where the camera will be orthogonal to the beam.
那如果说对于这个均匀一致性的话，我就会建议你可以放一个白纸在这个相机前面。
And with a separate camera with a low lens fall off, we'll take a picture where the beam is well exposed.
所以当这个白纸跟你的这个成像系统它的重心是正交的话，那然后就会比较容易来去测试，然后再用另外一个不同的相机，用一个比较低的这个镜头静音，然后再拍另外一张照片，当这个整个光束是非常大的曝光。
And then we can use an analysis utility to look at cross sections of that image through the beam.
那所以我们就用这个图像的分析。这个功能去看这两个，在这个两个图，在这个不同的在图像上面，什么地方是有交叉的这个光束的交叉。
You can translate a light meter across the beam, but that can be challenging for small beams.
可对于比较小的光束的话，你虽然可以用比较低的这个光亮度的，可以或者是这个测光器来做，但是这个比较难做。比较有挑战性。
And then as far as the expansion or divergence, you can measure the size of the beam where the camera will be, and then repeat that measurement at different distances.
所以如果说是在一个比较发散或者比较扩散的一个光的状况，你可以直接在这个光束的尺寸的测量，那测量这个光束的尺寸，那还有这个相机会在这尺寸的，在这个范围的什么地方，然后再重复做这样的测量。
For the light level measurement, if the beam is truly collimated, then the radiance, ignoring the loss within the air, the radiance will not change with distance.
但是如果说这是个准值的一个光束的话，那我们就可以把它发散出来那些光的这个损失，就可以不要去考虑，而且，就不用去，而且就不用去改变这个拍摄的距离。
And so,
如果是测试这个 光的亮度的话。
So you can measure the irradiance or the lux level of the source at the camera to source distance and at about twice the camera source distance.
所以在这上面有讲得很清楚，就是说你可以去测试大概是我们的相机到光源的这个距离的两倍，用这样子的方式来测试。
Light level, using a light level meter to measure the irradiance at the camera source test distance.
所以就可以用这个测光器 来测光，在这个相机还有到这个我们的光源的这个 测试的距离。
Okay, that was the last question I had prepared to answer. I think there's a set of other questions. I think I'm just going to pick one last question here. It says, will the flare problem be problematic for the application of traffic identification?
在这个我们要怎么样去看到它的which one? I don't see
sorry, I was down near the bottom.
Which time?
Anonymous attendee. Third from the bottom. Sorry.
Okay, 1107, right?
Yes.
那说这个他说他想问问看说在这个杂光会耀斑的这个问题，如果说对于这个对于像这个交通，就是在这个交通灯上面的，是不是会有一个影响？
So the question of how stray light affects computer vision things like identifying cars or identifying signal lights is a complicated question.
所以这个问题不知道你是在问说是要去侦测去分辨移动的车子物体，还是去分辨这个交通号志，这是非常复杂的，而且是不一样的问题。
If you have a bright source right next to your traffic light, that could definitely cause you to not be able to identify that source.
就像如果说我们你在你的交通号志灯旁边有一个非常亮的一个灯源。那或是非常亮的一个光源，就像是太阳光，刚刚前面有看到这个照片，那当然就是非常难去侦测或是看到，去分辨到这个交通号志灯。
I think also the potential to detect ghosts as real objects is could be a problem in these kinds of systems.
那如果说在这种系统上面它有这个鬼影或者是有这个鬼像的话，那也是非常难分辨。
So in order to do this, you need to go, you need to understand your stray light and also apply that stray light into simulations because it could be very, very difficult to capture out in the real world the kind of scenes that will include all types of stray light.
所以如果说你知道你的成像系统他们本来就是会有这样的杂散光的反应的响应的话，那所以就最好是先用模拟的方式，因为在真实的场景里面很难真正的去拍摄到一样的你想要测试到这个鬼影或者是杂光。
The challenge with automotive imaging, the reason why we want to test, so make it such a comprehensive test isWe want to find the failure modes that are very rare because there could be lives that are saved if we're able to avoid those failures.
所以在车载系统上面最大的挑战就是说，因为我们在真实的场景上面常常说会碰到的是真实的生命，我们不想因为我们这个比如说像我们现在杂散光的这样子的测试而测试上的失败而造成真实的生活上应用上而造成性命的损失。
So we hope these tools will be useful for the industry to understand the quality of their cameras and build better cameras.
所以我希望我们所提供的这些工具可以非常好的帮助到这个行各个行业里面的这个应用，所以可以设计制造出更好的相机。
That's all we have time for today. I appreciate your time and thank you to Jackson and also to Ching for translating.
我想今天这时间就到这里，谢谢 Jackson， 也谢谢 Ching 的这个翻译。
And thanks to the IMATES team who's worked very hard on this new feature.
谢谢 IMATES 我们的团队，因为对于这个新的这个功能，我们大家都花了非常多的心力。
And I hope you have a great day. 谢谢你。
真的是谢谢大家，希望大家有美好的一天。Thank you.